is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 The Lion of Judah, He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb.
Just as I am without one plea, but that Thy blood was shed for me, and that Thou biddest me come to Thee, O Lamb of God.
Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to Thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come. I come broken to be mended, I come wounded to be healed, I come desperate to be rescued, I come empty to be filled, I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb, and I'm welcomed with open arms, praise God, just as I am. Just as I am, I would be lost, but mercy and grace my free. Glory in Your cross, O Lamb of God.
come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am. I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am. Praise God, just as I
good morning. Welcome to our service online from First Baptist Church. When I think of the 4th of July, I think of freedom. I looked up the word for freedom in the dictionary and I found 8 definitions, and I'd like to share 3 of them with you today. The first one is the condition of being free from restraints, and that seems to be the prevailing thought of our society today. They want to be free to do what they please and when they want to do things apart from following God's law. A second definition is liberty of the person from slavery, oppression, or incarceration. Thirdly, political independence, possession of civil rights, and immunity from the arbitrary exercise of authority. Yesterday, we celebrated 244 years of freedom as the United States of America. Our forefathers came to this country to be free from oppression from their government and oppression from a state religion. They wanted to be free to worship as they chose and to live and to be governed by, I believe, God's law. That's why they came to America. In 1775, the 13 colonies revolted against the British government, and they declared independence. The American Revolution War was fought very ably and led very ably by George Washington. On July 4th, 1776, the Declaration of Independence was passed, which declared our independence, and it is from that date, July the 4th, 1776, that we trace our anniversary and our birth date as a nation. We prevailed through the Revolutionary War. We prevailed through the Civil War, World War I, World War II. We prevailed through the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and the Iraqi War. We were not only fighting for our freedom, but we were fighting for the freedom of other people so that people could be free, free to live according to the dictates of their heart, and hopefully to follow God. We prevailed through all of these things so that we could enjoy our freedom as a nation and as a people. Today we are fighting another war. It is a war that we are fighting from within. It is a war of good and evil. There are people in our country who believe that we ought to change our way of living and our belief system, especially in God. And they're doing what they can do to remove the absolutes in our country so they can continue to live as they so desire and as they please without living according to the truth of God's Word. If you are a student of prophecy, from all accounts of what I've heard and what I've read, there is no mention of the United States or America at the end of time. It's as if we did not exist, or if we do exist, it's not as a major factor at the end time. And there, I believe, is a reason for this. Any nation that turns their back on God and does not recognize Him in any way, they are in danger of being under the judgment and the wrath of God. Israel, years ago, they turned their back on God. They rejected God and His Word, and they faced the judgment of God. And if Israel faced the judgment of God, surely America will face the judgment of God in years to come. Let me read to you from 2 Chronicles 7:19 and 20. But if you turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments, which I have set before you, and go out and serve other gods and worship them, then I will uproot you from my land, which I have given them, and this house, which I have sanctified for my name, I will cast out of my sight and will make it a proverb and a byword among all nations. For several decades, America has been turning her back on God and also His truth and principles. Many believe and have believed that America was founded upon Christian biblical principles and has been known as a Christian nation. But if you Google the question of whether or not America was a Christian nation are founded on biblical principles, you will find that they state that that America was not founded on biblical principles and was not considered a Christian nation. That just goes to prove to me that what you see on the internet is not always true, and I believe that Google is wrong. I do believe that we were founded upon biblical principles and that we were considered, and in some degree still considered, as a Christian nation, although people are trying to remove that status from history and from everyday living today. There have been three major nails that have been nailed into the coffin of America in the past 40 years. And those nails that they have nailed into that coffin, it is to prove that we were not founded on biblical principles and that we were not a Christian nation. The first nail was when prayer was taken out of school. On June the 25th, 1962, in Engle versus Vitale, the United States Supreme Court ruled that based on the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment, that the government can't sponsor a prayer and require school children to say it. Now, what is the Establishment Clause? Here it is. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Our founding fathers did not want a state religion. That's what the Establishment Clause is all about. It is for the purpose of not us as a nation not having a state religion. It was not meant to take prayer out of school. When you think of praying in school, most religions, as far as I know, they pray. They may pray to a different God, but they pray. So what has the Establishment Clause got to do with taking prayer out of school? But our government, the Supreme Court, used that to take prayer out of school. It was followed in 1963 by the removing of the Bible and the teaching of the Bible from schools. Now, I grew up in the 40s and the 50s. Back in those decades, those were great decades. People were not all Christians, but we had good morals. People worked together. There was unity in our country, even though we went through World War II, and even in 1950 when we went through the Korean War conflict. We were together. We had good morals. We still abided by really the Ten Commandments. But even the Ten Commandments nowadays, they're not allowed to be shown, not allowed to be displayed on government property, and they would like to just discard them from even private property because they want to remove those absolutes so they can be free to do as they please. So that is the second nail that was nailed into the coffin of America. And following that, we can't even display the Ten Commandments anymore. Now, the second nail that was nailed into the coffin of America was when abortion was legalized. This happened in 1963 with Roe versus Wade. Since that time, 93 million babies have been murdered, and more continue to be murdered day by day. Let me read you what the Bible says about those babies in the mother's womb from Psalm 139, beginning with verse 13. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you. When I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth, to me that's the mother's womb. Your eyes saw my substance. What is that substance? That would be the embryo or the fetus. Being yet unformed, and in your book they are all written. The days fashioned for me when as yet there were none of them. How can we say that a fetus is not a child or not a baby in the mother's womb? Let me read to you from Leviticus 20, verse 2, of what Israel did. Again, thou shalt say to the children of Israel, whoever he be of the children of Israel, or of the strangers that sojourn in Israel, that giveth any of its seed unto Moloch, he shall surely be put to death. The people of the land shall stone him with stones. Israel was offering their children and their babies to the god Moloch, and they incurred the wrath and the judgment of God. And if God brought, once again, if he brought judgment against Israel, he will surely bring judgment against America for us killing our own children. Thirdly, the third nail in the coffin of America was when the Supreme Court changed the definition of marriage. This happened on June 26, 2015, in the case of Obergefell versus Hodges. Since then, traditional heterosexual marriages has suffered, and we have less and less traditional heterosexual marriages than ever before. What people are doing, since marriage has been devalued and anybody can marry anybody they want to, traditional marriages has suffered. And so what people are doing, they are just simply living together. When I was young and growing up in the 40s and 50s, and even before that, we called it shacking up. And that was a disgrace and sorrow and shame. But nowadays, society looks upon that favorably. There are many Christians who are looking upon it favorably. On my street alone, I know of 5 couples that are living together without being married. Something is wrong in our country. Folks, to me, they are going against the rule of God and God's law, and they're living in sin. And yet we condone it. We sanction it. And you say, well, I don't sanction that. I don't believe in that. But yes, we do. We sanction that and we condone it when we keep our mouths shut. And we keep our mouths shut because we do not want to offend our families, our friends, and even our children. But wouldn't it be better to offend them? It would cause them to consider and reconsider the claims of God on their life and the rule of God that's from God's word than to go ahead and live in sin and face the judgment and the wrath of God and miss out on the blessings of God. We need to rethink how we are living for the Lord and what we need to do to change. We live in a free country. I enjoy living in this country. I'm proud of America. I've always been proud to be an American. And I'm thankful for the freedom that we have enjoyed. But beloved, even though we are living in a country that's sliding away from God more and more day by day, we can still be free. Because you see, our freedom does not depend upon our government or our country being free as a nation. Our freedom depends upon our relationship with Jesus Christ. We can be free. Even though we may be a prisoner in prison, we can be free in Jesus Christ. So first of all, we are free in Christ. Galatians 5:1 says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with a yoke of bondage." How did Christ make us free? And what do we have to do to receive this freedom? Well, let me share with you what Paul says in Colossians, the first chapter, verses 19 and 20. "For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross." We are to stand fast in the liberty that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus died on that cross and shed his blood and became sin for us so that you and I could be free. Free to worship. Free to be in heaven with him. He died. He gave his life for our freedom. And we receive that freedom when we personally receive Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. When we believe the gospel, the death and the burial and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Folks, we are free in Christ. We are free to serve him. We are free to live for him and to serve him faithfully. Several years ago, there was a movie made. It was called Live Free or Die Hard, starring Bruce Willis. But for a Christian, it is different. It should be, and it will be, and is, for a Christian, live free and die hard. Pastor, we don't want to die hard. We want to live free, but we don't want to die hard. More and more Christians, even though they're free, they're dying hard. And as we progress in this life in America, if America does not change, we will see more and more Christians dying hard. We can look back in history and see this so. Even in our recent history around the world, people are living free, but they are dying hard. They're having to give their life because of their stand and belief in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Look at Jesus. There was no freer man than Jesus Christ, but Jesus died a hard death. He was beaten at his trial. He went to the cross. They nailed him in his hands and his feet with nails. They pierced his side. They put a crown of thorns on his head. Jesus died hard. And he died hard so that you and I could be free. Free to worship. Free to live for the Lord. Free even though we're slaves to a society that does not believe in God. And that is happening more and more every day. But we're free in Christ. And let's look at the Apostle Paul. Paul was free. And yet he died hard. He was shipwrecked. He was beaten a number of times, stoned, and he was beheaded. And he lived free, but he died hard. And then there was the Apostle Peter. He died, he lived free. He was a free man, but he also died hard. He was crucified upside down. And this was true of every disciple. They lived free and they died hard, except for John the disciple. And we need to be thankful that John lived to be an old man. He lived to be as old as I am, and even older, probably into his 90s. If he had died a martyr at an earlier death, we would not have 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and we would not have the Revelation. Aren't we thankful that God spared him and allowed him to live long enough so that he could pen those books for our benefit to give us hope and strength and encouragement for this life and for the life to come? We need to be thankful that God spared him so that we could be free. We may not have to die hard. I hope that none of us have to die hard. But there is a possibility that as time goes on and as our country slides further and further into sin, unless something happens, we eventually are people that follow us, our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, they may die hard. They'll be free, but they may die hard. Our hope is in the Lord, and we just need to trust him to take care of us during this time. Secondly, we are to be free in knowing the truth. John 8:32 says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." What is the truth? Pilate asked that question, and the truth stood right before him, and he did not recognize it. That's what's happening to our country today. People don't know what the truth is. They made up their own truth. Whatever they want to do is their truth. Whatever makes them happy is their truth. The truth, in reality, is Jesus Christ, and the truth is his word. And if we want to know the truth and be set free, we must know and follow the Lord Jesus Christ, for he is the truth. We do not enjoy our freedom in Christ, and there are many Christians who are not enjoying their freedom because they don't know what the truth is. And since they don't know what the truth is, they're going to live as they please and do as they please without the principles, the guiding principles of the Word of God in and for and upon their lives. To know the truth, we have to read the Word of God because his Word is truth. People are living in sin. Christians continue to live in sin and in rebellion because they're not in God's Word. And when you're living in sin, you're not going to be in God's Word. The truth will set us free, but if we're not reading God's word, how can we be free and how can we know the truth? That's why so many people, they are suffering from indifference and complacency and personal sins, and sharing the gospel is not in their vocabulary. If we're living in sin, if we're in rebellion against God, we're not going to share the gospel. And we have many Christians today, they are not sharing the gospel. We may not be sharing the gospel. And if we're not in God's Word and reading what God's Word says, we won't be sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if we are content with living in sin, we won't be in God's Word. We won't be in worship. We won't be in church with other fellow believers and have fellowship with them because we live like we please and we enjoy living in sin. The enjoyment of sin does not last. And someday it will come crashing down upon us. America is sliding down a slippery slope to destruction because she doesn't know or she waters down the truth of God's word. And it's not just people outside the church. It is God's people inside the church, even pastors, who water down the truth of God's word. Thirdly, we have a responsibility in being free, and we will reap the reward of being free. Romans 6:22 says, "But now having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end everlasting life." First of all, Paul says we are to have fruit to holiness. The word holiness there can also be translated sanctification or being set apart, separation is another translation of that word. We are set apart unto God to do what God calls us to do. We're set apart to have fruit unto holiness. We are to reverence God, love God, and obey God's word. That's what God called us to do. He called us to be separate. But how can we be separate if we neglect his word and knowing what the truth is about life and how to live life? God saved us to bear fruit. And our life is to be one of separation to God. Now, what fruit are we bearing? What kind of fruit are we bearing? Well, let's look at Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Ephesians 5:9. For this fruit of the Spirit is all goodness and righteousness and truth. Matthew 7:16. You will know them by their fruits. Matthew 7:20. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. How are we known? How are you known? We're known by our fruits. That is our identification. People identify us according to the fruit that we are bearing. So what kind of fruit are we bearing? How does our life look? Does our life look like a dried up prune? Does it look like a rotten apple or an overripe banana? Or does it look like a cluster of red, ripe, delicious grapes? We are known by our fruit. And probably most of us, if not all of us, have experienced all of these. Sometimes my life is looked upon as just a dried up prune. When I'm not close to God and when I'm not in His Word and not seeking the truth, I'm just a rotten apple. At times my life is like a cluster of grapes, and I want it to be that way more and more. And I trust that you have that feeling too and that belief. But we're known for our fruit. We have an identification, and God wants us to bear fruit unto holiness, separation unto God, set apart unto Him, to live for Him, and to be a blessing to us. The people that we come in contact with, if they see us just as a dried up prune, they're not going to believe us. If they see us in our fruit displaying nothing but like a rotten apple, they're not going to believe us. But if they see something that's good, if they see something that identifies with God, they perhaps will listen and respond to what we're saying and what we would like for them to believe and to do. So how are we known? How are you known? That's our identification. We are not to live a secret life. We are to bear fruit unto holiness. Our reward in doing this is eternal life. Life in heaven with God. In conclusion, you may remember the famous statement of Martin Luther King Jr. in his famous speech on I Have a Dream. At the end of that speech, he said, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last." He wanted to be free to live for the Lord. He wanted to have, his dream was to be free to have equality as others had. We should also have a dream to be free. Free as a Christian. Free as brothers and sisters in Christ, free to live and to share our faith and not be ridiculed and not have to worry about riots and murders and killings and threats upon our lives as a Christian because of what we believe. Before we knew Christ, we were slaves to sin. We had no hope for eternal life. But then Jesus came into our lives and gave us freedom. So I'm asking you the question, are you free? Has Jesus come into your life? If you believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ, that He is who He say he is and was, that He's the Son of God, and He did come to this earth and died and was buried and resurrected, if you believe that and by faith ask Him to be your Savior and forgive your sins and turn to Him, you will be saved. In Romans we read, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And I trust that you will do that if you have not done that. Give your life to Jesus. We can be free. We may live eventually in a country that's not free, but we're always free in Christ. We have freedom in Him. And at the end of our life, when we have received Jesus as our Savior, we can say, and perhaps have said, when we know Jesus and received Him, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last. May God bless you. May you enjoy your freedom. May you know the truth of God. May you study God's Word, and may it be very real to you. Father, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for your freedom. Thank you for your mercy. God, we pray for our nation. It is on a slippery slope, Father, and there seems to be no hope, and there will not be any hope unless we as God's people make a stand, for revival comes when we as God's people confess our sin and turn from our wicked ways. Lord, bless our country. Be with us, Lord, as a nation. Help us to enjoy our freedom, Father. Forgive us of our sins, and help us to bear fruit unto righteousness and holiness, God. We love you, Father. Thank you, God, for loving us. And it's in Jesus' name I pray, Father. Amen. God bless you.
Hey, church family. Here's a few things that you should be aware of that's going on here at First Baptist and in the coming weeks. As you know, the coronavirus is still a very real part of our world right now. And across the nation, we're seeing spikes in positive test cases and hospitalizations, including in Arkansas. Our governor has recently mentioned that many of our cases that we have seen and groupings of cases have been linked or traced back to church attendance. Because, frankly, church attendance means a large group of people coming together. So it's not surprising. But this is just a reminder to practice safe protocols. Practice the safe social distancing when you come to our building. That means 6 feet apart, front and back, side to side, from those who are not part of your household. Use hand sanitizer. When you come into the building, we encourage you to wear a mask. But ultimately, it's your choice. But we, as your staff, want to encourage you to think of others and maybe what they feel or think, to just outdo one another in showing honor, as Romans 12:10 tells us. Love one another, care for one another, be safe. For those of you who don't feel like you can be here on campus with us, that's okay. If you've had a fever recently, if you have a cough, if you're feeling sick in general, or maybe you just have underlying health conditions that generally prohibit you from being here on campus with us safely, by all means, worship God at home with your family. That's why we have online services. That's why we have these online resources, so that you can worship safely and keep yourself healthy during this time. Speaking of the coronavirus, back around Easter time, we had to shut everything down. We couldn't meet on campus at all. A lot of things had to be put on hold, including raising funds for our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering seeks to raise funds for North American missions, for church planters, church revitalization specialists, and missionaries all over Canada, the U.S., and Mexico. North America. So, because we missed that opportunity when we normally would do it, we are now starting the Annie Armstrong Easter offering in the month of July. So whether you're on campus or at home, we want you to have the opportunity to give. If you'd like an Annie Armstrong envelope, they're in the lobby at our church building. If you can't be here on Sunday morning to worship with us and turn it in then, you can always stop by the church office and do so, or just send in a check and make sure you mark it Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Please watch this video to help remind us of what this is all about.
Sometimes people ask why. Why do we do this?
When we came up here, I didn't feel capable. Because I was scared.
Why do we take our families away from places that are familiar and move to places that are far off?
My wife was 9 months pregnant, and we did not know one person who lived in the city.
Why do we come to where there's nothing so we can try and start something?
The Lord really just, He broke my heart for this city before I stepped off the plane.
Why do we stress and strain and struggle and sweat just to make life better for someone else?
There's so many people that are broken, that are lost, and it's heartbreaking.
Yes, sometimes people ask why, and when they do, we tell them. There's places where the truth hasn't yet reached.
We need to share the gospel and reach out our community.
We tell them there's a God who loves them so much, he sent us.
God spoke to us, broke our hearts for the city, and God's call trumps all.
And we tell them there are people who love them so much, they give so that we can go.
When people give to missions, things happen. New believers are getting baptized. New churches are started.
So when people ask why, that's what we tell them. We tell them it's the gospel. It's all about the gospel.
Good morning. Part of the deacon body's responsibility at First Baptist is to make sure that the pulpit is filled in the event of a vacancy of the senior pastor. So with that in mind, we have been in contact with the Arkansas Baptist State Convention about their Smart Start program. This is an 8-week program that's designed to provide stability and focus for our church during this transition time as we begin the process of looking for the next man, the Joshua, that God has planned for us, for our pastor. The deacons have unanimously agreed that we should enter into this Smart Start program with the Arkansas Baptist State Convention, and it'll begin next Sunday. During this time, Bruce Venable, he's the team leader for the college and young adult or young leaders at the Arkansas Baptist State Convention, will lead us through this program by filling in the pulpit. But he'll also be meeting with different groups within the church, including the deacons, the staff, and the leadership council to help us organize and also to articulate what we need, not only in a long-term supply preacher, but also to provide some direction and guidance as we begin this process for looking for our next Joshua. Thank you.
Well, despite so many things not happening right now because of the pandemic and everything going on with Corona, there's still a lot happening at First Baptist Church. God is on the move, and we're excited about the future of our church. So I hope you have a great week, and God bless you all.